The year was 2018. The year that everyone decided this is the year we're going to put out a video project. Like some sort of Oprah show giveaway. You get a personal project, and you get a personal project. There's only one man crazy enough to review all these movies. Not that anyone asked, but one man nonetheless will review all of the movies this year. Pretty briefly, because there was a lot.
Get out!
Dang, dude.
He will get to it.
Down in front!
Just as soon as he finds a seat.
Down in front!
All right, seriously, sorry guys, one more thing.
All right, hey, does anyone need a go? Okay, come on, we're going! Jesus, stop!
Wow, hard to believe that time of year is on us again, where everyone puts out their movies. A lot this year, a lot of films. Because now the lines are bleeding, right? Things are coming out for free. Some things are just like 10 minutes long, but still called a movie. I don't know what to make of it. I tried to make a comprehensive list of all the things I consider to be the movies of the year. It's a long list. We're rating them in suit jackets. Four suits is the best that you can do. Five suits is the best you can do, actually. I just changed it. First of all, I'd like to say I think Transworld had it right this year when they did the Transworld Awards. They set up the movie categories into two. Short film, long film. Addressing a real thing that is happening now, a real shift in media, I appreciate that. That being said, I think that Blender was in fact the best short film. I think that Blender basically just captures the zeitgeist of what it means to be like a rail snowboarder at this time. I think it was said really well by this one random YouTube comment left by a person named Dane. It said, "Oh shit, this edit is super rad. I didn't know there were snowboarders like this and not the normie shit Red Bull videos." Damn, yeah, boom, okay, thank you, Dane. What we're seeing here with Blender is the trend of something that will be starting more and more in the future, a focus on personal projects, right? Because the idea of a snowboard part doesn't make as much sense anymore because it's not a part of a singular movie. It's all getting chopped up and put online anyway. So you're just like one person anyway, putting shit out now. It's the way it works. This being one of the better, newer examples that we've seen, they kind of nailed it. Also an insane project to go pro with, kind of the way it should be, right? Like if you're gonna announce that you're going pro for it to mean something, to have this piece to go with it, amazing. There's a lot of good stuff in here, you know, Derek Lever shows up. We have seen a couple hat grab clips in our day, but never ones that have defied gravity in this way. The Future of Yesterday, Transworld's movie. I've had a couple people express to me that they didn't think I was gonna go hard enough on this group of people because they're my friends. Everyone in this video has some pretty insane footage, right? Some really fucking good snowboarding goes on in this movie. There are definitely two big song faux pas, okay? One song, Kevin Backstrom's song, was in Dope 2, and Haldor's song was in The Weather is Weather, like Ryan Paul montage. It brought a lot of attention. These things happen over history, right? This has happened before. Do we have a stance on this? Hello and welcome to Stance Stance, the branding opportunity that practically wrote itself. Product shot! This is gonna be a monthly segment where I take a stance on various issues in the snowboard industry. Secondary product shot! This month's stance, is it ever acceptable to reuse a song that you know has been used before in anything having to do with action sports? Absolutely not. I'm sorry folks, but there's a no budge zone on this one, okay? A video part song makes up at least half the overall presentation of the video part. The second you reuse a song, half the video part's out the window, okay? Something also going on in here, we see some Smith grinds going down. Now, I think that realistically, the homies in this movie think that the Smith grind is funny. They've decided so. They probably don't really care if I make fun of it or not. To me, the Smith grind ban has not been lifted yet, okay? I can't look at this ironically and be like, so funny and sick, right? I'm kind of like, I don't know if Smith grinds are, I'm with that. This movie could have been movie of the year. There was a lot going on, a lot of great writing. The editing and stuff was good. Theo did a great job with it. Just the song thing. Kamikazu, Okay, Kamikazu definitely got a lot of hype as well. I really enjoyed this project. I want to say that first and foremost, some insane backcountry lines. This is like sort of like the opposite of Blender in terms of the snowboarding it's representing. With that being said, I would like to play devil's advocate here and point out the thing I did not like about Kamikazu, which is that I do not think that there is a single organic sound in that whole movie. We never hear like anyone talk or like laugh or yell. It's so strange and feeling impersonal. And Dustin Craven goes like insanely hard in this video. Like, I'm not even one to just like immediately be back in Dustin Craven's riding, but like this, he was juiced up. And it's very evident because he kind of like, one could argue stole the show a little bit. Some of these clips, like some of the most memorable clips in the movie, definitely coming from Craven. The soundtrack of this movie was great. Again, to wrap it up, just maybe one of the most impersonal feeling videos I've seen in a long time. Brown, okay, a video by Brown Cinema. This is a fan favorite, I think. A movie that I have noticed a lot of different people kind of throwing on in the background. Some of the clips I feel like in this film are seen elsewhere. There's a collection of snowboarders that kind of like cut deep into these various different sects, right? It's just kind of got this cool collection of people all throughout snowboarding. It's almost like a video magazine of what happened the year with like a bunch of different people's favorite snowboarders. It's cool. Not to mention the Xander Blackman coffin post credits attempt. What? Melodrama by John Stark, I liked, okay? I heard like a couple people grumbling about this one. I liked it. I found Bodhi's voiceover to be like ironically monotone and kind of funny. And like, maybe that's not what they were going for, but I thought it was like pretty funny. I was just like, damn, this is like awkward and like kind of hilarious. And it matched the sort of lighthearted nature of the movie in general. It wasn't as intense. It wasn't as loud. It wasn't as hard hitting and gritty. It was kind of fun. I heard one person say that it was John Stark's after lame. And I don't even think I wanna argue with that, okay? I think that that's an astute observation of this film. It's tamer, it's fun, it's more introspective. It is dramatic, it's a little dramatic, right? But it's fun to watch. Eric Leon's got this like wide array of spots. His ender is insane. Some of them are fun, like the statue shot. Some of them are just insane, like the ender. You got Bodhi's sign break sign, which is amazing and kind of like iconic. I'll feel like I'll remember that shot for a while. Some good cameos. Lewiff's obviously got some cameos, probably in the lead for cameos this year is Lewiff. Spencer Schubert maybe, who's also in this movie. Beta. Okay, honestly, if Beta was just free, I don't even think I would be mad about Beta, but I'm a little mad about Beta. As a project, It ends up feeling pretty amateur, right? Not that the editing was amateur, but some of the spot selection, and it just seemed like it was a year where everyone's kind of like making excuses. People got hurt. It was an Olympic year. I get it. I just feel like there wasn't a mentor in this project. And considering how crazy and over the top Snowboarder went with the marketing for an AM movie that then they then charged full price for, it's hard not to be like a little let down after that, right? Because you're like, damn, this wasn't bad, but it wasn't like, you know, you're allowed to make a good AM movie. I just don't think you should be fucking going hard, charging for it, promoting it. That's my thing. So many of the movies are free this year and this movie isn't. Why? There's a reason the movie isn't called Alpha. Okay, that's what I'm saying. Video of the year, Lick the Cat. It's not as good as I wanted it to be, right? I just wanted a little more because I think the Lick the Cat crew is a hilarious bunch of snowboarders who on their web edit side have put out some pretty insane, funny things. Like a different version of the Gremlins. The standout part in this movie for me, Max Warburton. I think Max Warburton had a part that like, I would go as far as to say maybe his best part, in my opinion. Really well-rounded, just like insane writing. I walked away from that part being like, Max Warburton is fucking sick. That's the main thing I remember about that movie. Stinky movie. I got sent this one. This was one of the ones that they went out of their way to send me, made sure to review it, which is why I feel bad saying that I didn't like it. The Uninvited. I think, well, yeah, the best like all-lady project that came out this year. I think that the year-by-year history of like these heater lady clips in the beginning was really cool to see, and it was like shed like a lot of light on some of the insane clips that have been filmed by women over the years that you might forget. Kennedy Deck though. Kennedy Deck comes in breakthrough part for me. She won Rookie of the Year, no question. I was fucking blown away by this part. Maria Thompson is just absolutely insane. Ender, like, duh, insane part. Hadn't really heard much about her. Blown away. Listen to the Eyes was another all ladies project. It was made by Vans. I don't think that this movie showcases writing that is per se innovative. There's a lot of front side power slashes, some dope airs. All in all, it's just like a project that is Vans is showcasing their lady riders, and that's cool. Not anything that crazy to watch. Dez's movie Fate Accompli. Fate Accompli, is that how I say it? Am I supposed to say it with an accent? The name is actually probably the hardest part about this movie because I had to actually look it up. Was this movie too deep? Maybe, honestly. I would like to say that I think it's funny that after such a dramatic intro about like losing sight of vision, the first clip in the movie is LeWiff front flipping off a rail. How do you feel about it? My verdict? LeWiff can do whatever the fuck he wants, obviously, right? That's the obvious answer. Nothing is always bad, and especially if LeWiff's doing it, it's probably good. I think Desiree has insane writing in this movie, and what's cool about Desiree's clips is that like, she is dedicated to only putting out good street clips, regardless of gender. Like, her clips are good clips. It's not good street clips because she's a girl. She has good clips. Postland Theory. I think by the time I started watching this movie, I started connecting it to snowboarders that I had like more of a relation to, because a lot of the riders in this are like Euro riders that I don't really know. So we got like RDM, of course, the LeWiff lookalike out here. My favorite is Dreddy Craig Cameron. Nah, wait, never mind. He actually did a front board and a bowler hat. So this guy is just like in a league of his own. But Kaz Lemons is the Kids' Choice Award winner of this movie, okay? Makes the film for me. He doesn't make the film, but he makes the film. You know what I'm saying? Manboys made a movie. It was called Selective Memory. There's similar clips between another project that half the Manboys are in called the Powderhounds movie. This is kind of an example of one of the times where I'm like, what is right here? You know, should you dedicate all of your clips to one project, or is it better to get them seen in both? I know that the writer's perspective, the second answer is better, but as a viewer, I don't know. And now we have like 12 projects going this year, like no, 50 I should say, half of which have clips that are like in everything else too. So it gets weird and confusing. Too Hard made a movie, it's called Seven. I think it's a stretch to call this a movie, but whatever, it's like 10 minutes. It's not bad, but it's definitely more intentional of being a project of ladies as opposed to just like being a cool project. Also, I don't know who the hell Nora Beck is and how I've never heard of her, but the ending footage in this is insane. She's really good. Dinosaurs movie, it was fine. I actually think it was better than I expected. I expected it to be a little grittier, a little less put together. It was good. The old guy is also a legend. I should know his name. This old dude who's like getting clips is like a huge legend. EP, a project by Mike Rav, Brandon Cocard. How are you gonna hate on this one, right? One of the most original projects of the year. They create a soundtrack to the riding that they film. They do it all in like 3 weeks. Snack Monk is also an amazing song, right? High Octane was Austin Sweeten and Sean Lucy's project. It starts out pretty lo-fi and very cruisy, and then eventually just works its way up to like unbelievable pillow sections with Travis Rice, where you're like, is this real? Project that somehow seemed to fall through the cracks, but I think it's one of the best, is Soft by Christian Holler. Kind of the side hit euphoria vibe that I wish was utilized more in snowboarding. This is just like a must watch, and I think this is the one that like got mentioned the least. Method Movie 3, all right. I like what Method is doing when they make movies, right? This is gonna be a cross-court burn. This is what the Absinthe movie should have looked like, right? A handful of European riders, some of which we don't know, some of which we obviously do, and then a handful of Americans that we like. And the movie's like a half hour. That's good, we like that. All in a Dream, the project by Danny Davis. This project was a little different than any of the other movies, mostly because it was kind of like this storyboarded quest that you were going on, right? I think that this is a movie made for the general public, people who are watching ESPN, people who are watching X Games. Probably not a film for a core snowboarder, though any core snowboarder would relate to the places and the people involved, so it's a cool project to watch. I don't know if Of Course No Border is going to pay for this movie, but if you do get a chance to see it on TV, I highly recommend it. They do a good job. There's like a pretty extensive bald face section. They visit like all your favorite places, so it's cool to see. Stay tuned by Absinthe. I gotta be honest with you, Absinthe. I'm having a hard time staying tuned. Why? Because this movie is an hour long, right? Okay? That's a half hour too long. I don't know. I don't understand what's happening here. And in the name of this movie being so long, I'm gonna keep my review of it very short. Make it shorter. It's irritating because it feels like you guys have been making the same project for like 20 years. Only now it's getting longer in a time where everyone else is demanding shorter. I don't get it. And now we're done, right? This is over? Because this thing is like turning into an Absinthe movie. Hey-oh!